I don't even know where this crap comes from.
Hey, buddy.
And I'm getting tired of talking about this. Johnny Knox texted me this morning wondering where this crap comes from.
Hey, buddy.
If you guys keep making this stuff up and bringing this stuff up, you're going to deal with me.
Buddy.
That's what I said. That's what I said. I said I will read it. Don't you tell me what I need to say and what I don't need to say.
Who are you crapping?
Who are you crapping?
Telling the lies, you're putting it down, you're starting to make me cry.
Tired of watching fans of this town just be crapped on.
Oh, crap.
One of the things, Mike, that's been pointed out over the course of today and last night after the game is that you seem resigned to the fate after the game, that there wasn't much fire in you, and you sort of stood up before the media and said, well, you know, this is the way it is. Are you resigned to this fate?
You're the same guy that wrote about me when I did have the fire, that was the wrong thing to do. So who are you crapping?
Well, I'm just
don't
asking.
Don't crap me. No.
It is indeed time for our signature segment, Who You Crappin'? Boers and Bernstein, Chicago Sports Radio 670, The Score. And I want to keep this simple. Limit this to something someone said, not something someone did. And if you go too long, we had a little bit of that last week. Oh,
ooh,
God.
Didn't we?
Yeah, something bad is going to happen. So get to it.
We will start with Ian in Boston on The Score.
Hi, guys.
Hello.
This crap goes out to Fox NFL analyst Troy Aikman. During Sunday Seahawks 49ers game, Aikman discussed the rivalry between the two teams, how the coaches don't like each other, and how the rosters are built with the other team in mind. He ended by saying, when one of these teams releases a player, within 24 hours he's usually picked up by the other. Now, that statement does sound way too improbable to be taken seriously, but let's see just how far off Aikman is. NFL.com lists all transactions going back to July 2011. Since that time, the Seahawks and 49ers have waived, terminated, or failed to re-sign a combined 197 players. Guess how many of these were signed by the rival team? Three. And only one was picked up by the other team in the same season he was cut. Troy, NFL roster spots are prized commodities. This isn't the olden days when you'd sign someone off the street because they might have photocopied the other team's playbook. I understand that embellishment is part of your job, but you can't just make stuff up. Troy Aikman, who you crapping?
We've seen Aaron Rodgers be high on a few throws. Good start. And Who You Crappin' is brought to you by Sport Clips Haircuts with 70 Chicagoland locations to serve you. Sport Clips, it's good to be a guy. And brought to you by The Improv in Schaumburg, where comedy begins. Our comedy continues here. This from the JMC. It's for Kevin Harlan, who made some comments about Aaron Andrews' interview with Richard Sherman, such as, the interviewer in that instance was the whole story, and, quote, her reaction was more like drama queenish, and the gal was more on a stage. Come on, Kevin. Aaron did the interview similarly to any other dopey sideline reporter after a game ends. What I really want to ask you is, are you going to make these same comments when any other young, attractive female sideline reporters do this? Because there's a certain college student at Georgia who's blonde, young, attractive, has her own flashy website, who's dabbling in news reporting, is covering University of Georgia sports, and interned at NBC Green Bay, and was Miss Kansas Teen USA 2010. An aspiring sports reporter, Olivia Harlan. Good luck with your daughter's career, Kevin. And who you crapping?
Nice. Wow.
Joe in Plainfield, you're on The Score.
Hey, guys. This crap goes out to future Canadian Olympian and current Anaheim Duck, Ryan Getzlaf. After a Tuesday night loss to the Jets, Getzlaf said, quote, there's a lot of distractions this week with the outdoor games, so it's hard to focus and get 2 points. But that's no excuse. Well, Ryan, that's about as contradictory as Dan saying that the majority of callers are good. So I hope you meet up with the Black Widow terrorists in Russia, but I'm not wishing bad luck on you. Ryan Getzlaff, who you crapping?
Ryan Getzlaff getting some love.
Wow.
Bo Ryan's White Basketball says, this is my first
Double
crap.
Lightly.
Good luck with your first crap.
It goes out to Cindy Carlson, ex-wife of convicted murderer Carl Carlson. This past week, Dateline ran the story of the murder of Cindy's stepson, Levi. To make a long story short, her then-husband, Carl, flattened his own son by disabling the jack holding up a pickup truck while his son was working underneath it.
Yep, yep, yep.
What led Cindy to think foul play was involved rather than the accident Carl wanted to make it seem? Well, when she walked into the garage and found her stepson smushed and not breathing, she noticed that country music was playing on the radio in the garage, and she reasoned Levi wouldn't be caught dead listening to country music.
Oh God.
Cindy, young Levi was quite literally caught dead listening to country music. Cindy Carlson, who you crapping?
Cold, but true.
I love it. Chapel Hill and Zed on the score.
Hey, buddy.
Hey, buddy.
This crap's for my next-door neighbor, Roy Williams. Next in a string of scandals hitting UNC since Oliver Stone took over as dean when I arrived, UNC learning specialist Mary Willingham revealed that one of Williams' former players could not read or write. Roy Williams responded, "That's not fair. I've been here for 10 recruiting classes, I guess. We haven't brought anybody in like that." Well, Roy, next time you have a road game, say, Indiana, stop by a Marion County library and ask the librarian for a Coliformer Pacer version of Chicken Little. There you'll hear your former player, Tyler Hansborough. And trust me, although he may not be sure he's Tyler Hansborough, it's him. You'll know that once for sure you get through the first string of malaprops and half-pronounced words that 83 takes couldn't hide and 4 years at UNC couldn't fix. Perhaps a corn will fall on your head, and the only farther question you will have is, who am I crapping?
Sin's dead, baby.
Nicely done. In Grand Forks, North Dakota, this is Johnny New Guy on Who You Crapping on the score.
Hi, guys.
Hello.
This crap goes out to John Feinstein. On Wednesday, he had a sports minute in which he talked about the 88 Jamaican bobsled team that qualified for the Calgary Olympics and inspired the movie Cool Runnings. He goes on to say that the underdog story was great, and it might be happening again with them in the 2014 Sochi Olympics as Jamaica has qualified again, as if it's some huge accomplishment. Now, I'm not going to say qualifying for the Olympics is not a great accomplishment, but this is not an underdog story anymore. From 1988, the Calgary Games, to this year's Sochi Games, the Jamaican bobsled team has qualified for every Olympic Games but two, 2006 and 2010. Moreover, in 1994, they finished 14th, which might not look great until you consider they finished ahead of both American teams, both French teams, Japan, Sweden, Italy, Russia, and Australia, and finished only two spots behind Canada. They won gold in the 2000 Push Championships and set a two-man bobsled Olympic record at the 2002 Salt Lake Games, along with a track record at Park City. Olympians, yes. Underdogs, no. Fool me once, shame on you, John Feinstein. Fool me twice and ask yourself, who you crapping?
Suicide is a brain disease caused by persistent hits to the head.
The nut brown hair.
Oh, man.
Yarrack. That got both a yar and a bike cracky.
Yar
wow.
Cracky.
It's a yar cracky. Says, this goes out to score denizen of the dark, Les Grobstein.
Uh-oh.
A recent sleepless night found this listener tuning to the station's resident Nosferatu, and the grobber was deep in thought regarding Peyton Manning and the quarterback's legacy in terms of his inability to win enough of the big ones to satisfy his critics.
I see you all coming.
However fair or unfair the criticism may be, Les surmised we could all agree that by advancing past the AFC Championship, Manning had surely afforded himself a terrific opportunity to finally, quote, knock the goblins off his shoulder once and for all. Besides the fact that this disturbing image forced me to turn on all the lights in my creaky old home. The problem with the statement is the king of the malaprops has struck again. Les, I've got no doubt that toting about a filthy, drooling little monster upon one's shoulder would be a difficult cross to bear. And I can understand why you would have such grisly beasts on the brain, but in all likelihood, the idiom you were grasping for was knocking the monkey off his back. Robber, before you crawl your way back into your coffin adorned in one of your barbecue-stained T-shirts, two questions. One, can horses likewise ride upon the shoulders of said ghastly goblins? And who you crapping?
We know Peyton Manning, he's gotten some wins over New England, but mostly has lost to them. So this had to get rid of a few of those so-called goblins off his shoulder.
What? Well, I heard it. I don't know. Does it help me to hear it even?
I don't know.
What?
Here's unemployed lawyer on who you crapping.
Let's better knock the goblin out his monkey. Dan Bernstein has largely stopped making fun of 10 Seconds of Glory, preferring instead a detached or loud sigh. We get it, Dan. The segment has sucked, does suck, and will suck, and you're not changing your mind. Last Thursday's topic, named Don L's Boat. After hearing three incendiary responses, Bernstein got all huffy, protesting, quote, I thought it was going to be funny. Really, Dr. Logic? Time to update your favorite definition of insanity. Listening to 10 Seconds of Glory every day and expecting it to be good. Dan Bernstein, who you crapping?
Fantastic, but I thought it was out.
Yeah, okay. I guess I earned that one. Pete Hawk says Lou Aldang, reminiscing about the highlights of his time with the Bulls, mentioned making the All-Star game in 2012 and having the chance to show off a special T-shirt honoring Africa, which he wore under the league-issued warm-ups. Quote, I had the opportunity to have a great season and be in a position to uplift and let people know where I'm from and put Africa on the map, Dang said. Lou, I'm not sure who put Africa on the map, but I'm sure as hell it wasn't you. Lou Aldang, buy a globe. And who are you crapping? It's especially mean today. I like it. Mike in Lakeview, you're on the score.
Hey, guys, first crap.
Good luck with your first crap.
Crap goes to Hub Arkish. He was asked by a caller yesterday if Green Bay GM Ted Thompson would change his approach on free agency and being mostly ambivalent. Hub said that he didn't necessarily think he needed to change his approach. He just needed to be more consistent hitting on his draft picks. While I mostly agree with Hub, he put a bow on his argument saying, how many free agents did you see San Francisco sign? How many free agents has Denver signed? Well, Hub, since you asked, just this past offseason, Denver signed top cornerback Dominique Rodgers-Cromartie, team sack leader Sean Phillips, hot roast Terrence Knighton, Wes Welker, and to say the least, Peyton Dan Manning. Hub Arkish, who are you crapping?
Everybody thinks Seattle's the nuts.
Yar!
That's what we're doing.
The miss who you crapping. 312-644-6767. Still plenty of time to yell. And of course, on Boers and Bernstein, we are looking for the big finish. All right, the pressure is ratcheted up. Boers and Bernstein, Chicago Sports Radio, 670 The Score. We are looking for the big finish to who you crapping.
We roll on with Usual Suspect in Lake Bluff on The Score.
Good afternoon, gentlemen. This crap goes out to Dan McNeil, who on Monday's show, while recapping the NFC Championship Series, hypothesized that they might have used a crane to lower Cat Wilson into the stadium in order to sing the national anthem. Dan then suggested that she have a salad because he, quote, wants to see her around for a while. Dan went on to say he had to TiVo the performance because he actually missed it live because he was in the garage having a smoke. Dan McNeil, who you crap.
That's a beauty. That's a beauty.
As is this, Adam in Buffalo Grove. This goes out to PETA. To celebrate Martin Luther King Day, many people, politicians, celebrities, organizations, took a moment out of their day to commemorate one of the greatest men in American history. And predictably, many of those same people used their moment of commemoration to promote themselves or whatever cause they've championed. It's not surprising. It's predictable. But it doesn't make it any more sad or pathetic. Speaking of which, Monday, PETA took to the Twitter sphere with a tweet that said, We must continue to seek justice for everyone who is disadvantaged. Another that said, our lives begin to end the day we become silent about things that matter, over the picture of caged dogs. The use of these MLK quotes led to quite a few angry responses, accusing PETA of comparing African Americans to animals. And PETA responded with, the message that's meant is, please imagine if Martin Luther King were alive today, he would be fighting for us and saying all living beings deserve protection from needless cruelty.
Oh, wow.
Of course PETA isn't comparing African-Americans to animals. They may from time to time be callous in their disregard of human dignity in the pursuit of animal rights, but that doesn't mean they intentionally demean or offend people, unless you mean when in 2012 PETA argued that the amendment to the Constitution ending slavery applied to the orcas at SeaWorld, or when in 2012 at a collegiate exposition they showed a picture of black men lynched next to a cow hanging in a slaughterhouse, or perhaps in 2009 when they protested the Westminster Kennel Club by showing up dressed as Klan members claiming the club was trying to create a master race of dogs. I keep wishing PETA would go away, so they'd stop being the group that anyone who believes in animal rights immediately is associated with. PETA's a bad organization. Their methods and activities actively hinder broader acceptance of animal rights in the very organizations they protest. So as long as PETA stands as evidence of the ridiculousness of animal rights organizations, the movement they champion will be crippled. I wish someone could convince him of this. Failing that, I'll be content asking who you're crapping.
I hate those bastards.
There.
Oh, nicely done.
In Portage Park, Aaron, you're on the score.
Yes. This crap goes out to ESPN pioneer and current windbag, Chris Berman, who on Sunday's NFL Countdown show multiple times referred to San Francisco and Seattle as divisional and border rivals. Chris,
oops.
Chris,
oops.
There's a little state called Oregon in between California and Washington that might disagree with that statement. So please ask yourself two things. One, when am I going to eat myself into the grave? And two, ahoo-ya crappin'.
Back.
Tom Brady, asked about the Richard Sherman interview, said, we win with graciousness. When we lose, we could do better. Some teams don't always do that, or that's not their program. It's written by Matt in North Center. Ah, the Patriot way. The most nonsensical trope in the NFL, but let's talk about it. We can leave out the time that Brady chased down a referee to F-bomb him with class in Carolina this year. We'll leave out the apparent vapors Bill Belichick suffered as a result of the West Welker collision with Aqib Talib. We'll even leave out Brady's wife blaming his receivers for their most recent Super Bowl defeat. Those were losses. So let's talk about winning with grace. You've won by spying on your opponents. You won a lot of games this year with the help of assault and battery veterans Julian Edelman and Alfonso Denard. You've won in the past with grace purveyors such as Albert Hainsworth, Asante Samuel, and Chad Johnson. You've won with a creepy Cialis-infused owner. You've won with Gronk, who has all the drunken grace of an Axe body spray commercial. And you've won with an alleged murderer. And I bet dollars to donuts you'd do it again. Tom Brady, your greatness is unquestionable, yet unlike Richard Sherman, you've never been part of an interesting interview. I'm sure you have plenty of beautifully graceful things to enjoy this offseason. Please, go forth. Make us all jealous. But before you do, who you crapping? Quick Hits is in his car. He's on the score.
Yeah, this goes out to Richard Sherman, who is all up in arms about being called a thug. But he is in, and is paid to be in, a headphone commercial. And in that commercial, he is called a thug.
Mm-hmm.
Who are you crapping?
Nice. There you go.
Well, that's the essence of it. Real fast essence of it.
Teddy says, mere hours after the reporting of the signing of Masahiro Tanaka, Rick Morrissey scrawled out a column, said, come on, did you really think the Cubs were going to get Tanaka? Quote, we'll probably never know for sure how serious the Cubs were about landing Tanaka. Morrissey wrote, predicting fans will move on, skeptically and cluelessly. Three paragraphs later, he wrote, the proof of the Cubs' intentions will be in whether they take the money they had carved out for Tanaka and give it to other players who will help the team win more games in 2014.
Mm-hmm.
I see. So fans will never know if the Cubs sincerely went after Tanaka, except if the team buys past prime free agents right now so they can win in 2014, even though the team doesn't expect to compete until at least 2015 and more likely not until 2016. Rick, it's possible you're trolling us because you know very well the Cubs targeted Tanaka specifically because his prime age and skill set dovetailed nicely with their projected window for contending. But I don't think that's what's going on here. I think you're a short-sighted, impatient windsock who can't comprehend the one thing Epstein and Hoyer have repeated since they came to Chicago. There are no shortcuts here. Rick Morrissey, who you crappin'. Big Finish will not exactly be the Big Finish, but he's next on the score.
It's there, though.
Hi, guys. This crap goes out to old Packer, now color analyst James Lofton, who on Westwood One's pregame Niner Seahawk broadcast on the score inferred the number 12 in the Seahawk end zone didn't stand for Jim Zorn. It stood for the earthquake tremoring Seahawk fans. James, I think you're onto something, because perhaps Jim Zorn wore number 10. Ask yourself two questions. One, did I wear the number 80, Steve Largent? And two, who are you crapping?
I want to read one more before the Big Finish.
All right.
Florida House of Representatives candidate and historian novice Joshua Black is in the sights of Tinky Winky. Black, trying to prove that even bad publicity is good publicity, said that President Obama should be hanged for treason. He said, quote, I think the appropriate punishment is death. They killed Benedict Arnold. Obama shouldn't be allowed to kill Americans without a trial. Well, we can all debate as to whether or not a crazy man running for office wants a visit from the Secret Service while his opponents jump for joy. But my focus was Benedict Arnold. When you say they killed Benedict Arnold, to whom do you refer? Arnold did, in fact, commit treason. But his health complications started at the Battle of Saratoga when he was shot in the leg. From there, his health deteriorated well after he moved to London, where he finally died in 1801. Most likely from cardiac arrest stemming from edema.
Really deteriorated at that point.
Or as they called it, dropsy. So unless dropsy is the name of some secret United States government plan to execute Benedict Arnold, I must ask you, Joshua Black, who you crappin'? Check the manometer.
Oh, it's ready to burst. And where, pray tell, does it come from?
Mendota.
I was hoping you didn't remember that, but yeah.
Metro J will bear the pressure of closing out who you're crapping on the score.
Oh, I don't know if I can handle
yeah,
that.
Yeah, go. You got it.
This crap goes out to David Haw, Tribune columnist, frequent visitor on Mac and Spiegs, and apparent lover of Lou Aldang, who today told us, while opining why he was going, why we should all be so sad that Lou Aldang is gone, he said these words, Lou Aldang is the player you won't miss until he's gone. David, how are we going to miss him if he's still here? David Haw, who are you crapping?
Danny?
You may wonder with the things you say. Maybe
hey,
you were
buddy.
You must have thought that we were napping.
Hey, buddy!
Who you crappin'?